and welcome to the 5th Annual Alexandria Community Reads. My name is Cheryl Gorsuch. I'm the chairman of the school board, and it is my pleasure to welcome you here this evening. I was fortunate to have lunch today with William, along with the mayor of Alexandria, Bill Yule, and it was a wonderful experience. I know you are not here to listen to me this evening, but I do want to share a few things that I learned from talking with William earlier today. He genuinely beamed when I asked him his impressions of American food, and he shared the challenges he finds ordering at restaurants. Apparently, the restaurants in Malawi have no choices. Only one meal is served for everyone. We talked about the variety of colleges he considered attending in America and his desire to study somewhere warm. And then his surprising choice to attend Dartmouth in New Hampshire, a place that's much too cold for me. However, he wanted a place where he could interact with his professors and use the machine shop whenever he wanted. I have the pleasure this evening of acknowledging all of our partners who have participated in the planning, preparations, and hospitality for tonight's community read. This event would not have been possible without all of your efforts. We clearly keep setting the standard higher and higher each year, and I'm very impressed with the attention to every bit of detail, the cooperation and collaboration that has made this a successful event. So thank you all. To the City of Alexandria, especially the offices of Deborah Collins and Jennifer Harris. Thank you to Alexandria Library with Rose Dawson and her staff. A thank you to the PTA Council and the President, Linda Kelly. Alexandria Literacy Roundtable with Gwen Mullins and Jim Roberts. T.C. Williams High School, especially Pirouette Hall and Michael Cohen. The ACPS Department of Student Support and Institutional Advancement includes Chase, Kelly, and Philippa, and the whole team. The ACPS Department of Curriculum and Instruction, Greg, John, Jody, Suzanne, Melissa, Ebony, Melanie, Natalie, Jane, Bethany, Tanisha, and Donna. Our ACPS middle schools, all the eighth grade teams and principals, the library media specialists, our art teachers, and of course our elementary administrators, especially Brandon Davis for coordinating the elementary involvement. We are thrilled to have William Kamkwamba with us today. I hope he has enjoyed interacting with our students throughout the day, and I know they have appreciated his adventurous stories and enthralling, inspiring experiences in Malawi. William, on behalf of the entire City of Alexandria, I welcome you to T.C. Williams High School. I know our entire community has enjoyed your book and are excited to hear from you this evening.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Conrado Castro, and this is a short poem entitled Queen Selma. Queen Selma, it may be true that I'm the opposite of you, but doesn't the sun always make room for the moon? Doesn't the moon always make room for the sun? We can combine as one. Organism in the solar system, dancing to the adaptive rhythm of our ancestors, because brilliance is in your lineage, inscripted on papyrus with brush strokes of desirable paint. From Ghana to Mali to Songhai, from Nubia to the Blue River, I'll wait for your arrival, because I know tough tribulations will always be caressed by your patience. You symbolize wisdom in its purest form, and speak Amharic while I speak numeric, yet I feel reborn. You understand that a palace is not a need, but an attractive luxury indeed. You're my Ethiopian queen. Thank you.
Good morning. Oh, I'm sorry. Good evening. Going back to earlier. My name is Michaela Noel, and I go to Francis C. Hammond 1 in Alexandria, here. And my transfer task, my teacher suggested to me that I should read a letter to Mr. Kamkwamba. And at first I was like, you know, well, I don't really, you know, I don't think I'll be able to do that. But after reading the book, I came to realize that I had to do this. So here's my letter to Mr. Kwamkwamba. Dear Mr. Kwamkwamba, you're an amazing man. Did you know that? When I read your book, I couldn't help but smile at your achievements. As a young girl growing up in a privileged family, I've never had to starve, labor, or appreciate the little things in life. But after reading your book, I realized that not everyone can say this. You've come from a place of poverty and took the things that were nothing to us and turned them into something for you and your community. I've seen homelessness and starvation in the DC area, but I've never felt the impact it can all have on one person, and it doesn't even compare to what you had to go through. We definitely don't know what goes on in our world, and you showed us what it's like on the other side of the ocean. I mean, what kid goes out in American society and builds a windmill? No kid, because we don't have to. But in Africa and in other places of poverty, nothing comes easy. Reading your book made me curious about the effects of droughts. As a result of my research, I discovered that natural disasters happen more often than we care to count. And upon hearing and seeing you speak at TED, I was even more amazed because I've always felt that being on TED is an extraordinary opportunity and accomplishment. I have a word for you, adversity, which is a meaningful word. You have proved that you can do things too, even without a good education. You have paved the road for anyone who has read this book and learned something. I mean, you built a windmill just from reading books and using your own skills. You fought, you won, and I don't even know how to express how much your book has impacted my view of the world and what is possible. However, I now know that I am not just a privileged girl. I am a lady who can, if she wants to, do anything. Because as long as you have the goal and the determination, you can do anything, just like the boy who harnessed the wind. Thank you.
So if there's any question about why we're here, I think our two students gave us insight about why we do this as a community. Michaela, you read this morning to your classmates that letter to William. I shared that with members of the board the other night because your principal was good enough to send it to me ahead of time. And I sat next to William and I was watching his face, which I can't see really clearly because the lights aren't on, but I was watching his face as you read those words. And I could see that he was as touched, and he could talk about that, as we all were here today, this evening. But something extraordinary happened. In all my years, I've never seen anything like it before. This morning, this hall was filled with over 900 eighth graders. Just catch your breath on that image alone. And there were 900 eighth graders here who listened attentively, who cared deeply about a story, who admired not only their classmates speaking, but our guest author. And the most amazing thing happened twice, standing ovations. Can you imagine eighth graders quietly then exploding into applause for a very special person? And so I've been administrator in many places for a long time, and I've seen lots of activities with kids, many of which were positive. But never before have I seen together a student body coming together and rising to their feet for an author. So you, young man, William, bring to us a spark, a pleasure about life that many of us are seeking. Debbie and I often go to, my wife Debbie, and I often go to bookstores on weekends and we browse and we look for books. And I came across this wonderful book last year, took it home and said, you know, here's a read. It looks very different. And I fell in love with the book. In fact, I fell in love with it so much that we bought copies of it for all of our administrators for last year for our summer leadership academy. And then we loved it so much, we bought copies for all of our eighth graders and we bought picture book copies for all of our elementary kids. And so, William, from your story, that spark that is within you, it has, I think, passes a torch from your village in Malawi to our students here and their voices that you've heard. And we're so appreciative that you've taken that spark that's within you and shared it with others. I told William this morning two things in conversation because I had the good fortune to spend time with him and Suzanne Maxey, and I asked him, you know, what do you do after Dartmouth? What's next? And I think of all the things you've written and said, William, this to me is one of the most important and special. You said, after I finish, I'm going to go home. I'm going to take the skills and the knowledge I've learned and give it back to my people. I'm going to solve more problems. I would hope that our students also heard that story, that we can and we must, as humans, pass that torch on, not just in terms of our own spark, but in care and responsibility for others. And the final piece of my simple conversation with William this morning was about family, because I told him I may be the only person in the world reading his story this way, and I know many of you have read it, but I look at his story as a love story. It's a family united for cause, for survival, for care. And they, in some ways, have taught us across this world about how to survive and to flourish and to, in fact, stay intact as a family. And boy, if there's a story in America that we need to hear and need to learn from other families across the world, it is that, about caring and working together and moving ahead. So we thank you for all of that. So we have a gift for you, a very special gift. I'd ask Mr. Francis Chase to come up. If you'd come up, William, also. We wish as a community not just to thank you in words, and Ambassador, if you would join us also, I'll introduce you in a second, but we have a student picture. That we would like to present to you that you could take back to those warm climates in northern New Hampshire at Dartmouth. And wait, don't go too far. Chase, you want to introduce? Alex, come here. Okay. I'll read it.
Go ahead. This particular piece was done by Alex, and the project was you had to take what William did, just take found objects and create these beautiful pieces of art. And this particular piece just seemed to catch everyone's eye. So we thought it'd be a great idea to have Alex himself, the aspiring artist, to present it to William. And he wanted the superintendent to read it for us.
I once met a boy who didn't talk too much. Every day he worked in the kitchen, washing dishes and such. He was great at building things, and one day he dropped these apron strings, that creative boy who didn't talk too much. So William, do you want to present so we get a picture? Thank you, Chase. Great job. It is my very special honor, my distinct pleasure, to introduce to you somebody who knows William, knows his story, and knows his country well. We are extremely honored this evening to have Steve Medenchi. Did I do it? All right. And I love his title. I'm going to talk with the school board about something like this. Ambassador Extraordinary and Plenipotentiary of the Republic of Malawi to the United States. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Malawi Ambassador.
Thank you very much, Superintendent, for those complimentary words. Good evening. The Honorable Gorsuch, Superintendent Sherman, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for inviting me to join you this evening at this event honoring William Kankwamba, my compatriot from Malawi. Malawi is in Southeast Africa, near Mozambique. William's story is truly an incredible and amazing story. Walter Isaacson, the author of the books Easton and Benjamin Franklin, has described this story as follows, and I quote, "This is an amazing, inspiring, and heartwarming story. It's about harnessing the power not just of the wind, but of imagination and ingenuity. Those are the most important forces we have for saving our planet End of quote. William's story has captivated the world in many ways. It goes to show that given the opportunity and the means, all people, rich or poor, big or small, black or white, are capable, through the power of imagination and creativity, of shaping their own future and destiny, and those of their communities, be it in Africa or anywhere else across the world. William harnessed his own imagination to create light at the end of the tunnel for millions across the world who are struggling every day just to make ends meet. It is a story of hope, determination, and courage of a young Malawian who refused to be prevented by abject poverty to attain his dreams. William was born in Malawi on August 5th, 1987, in a poor family of farmers. He dropped out of school because his father was unable to pay school fees following a severe drought in Malawi in 2000 that destroyed his father's crops. His father then could not sell and earn money to pay for school fees. Undeterred by that misfortune, William self-taught himself how to build a windmill after reading a science book at his village school library. What followed is truly remarkable. After making his windmill, William enrolled at African Bible Christian Academy College in Malawi, and then at the African Leadership Academy, a pan-African high school in South Africa, before finding his way to Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire. He is expected to graduate in 2014. He has been invited to tell his story at various international meetings, including the World Economic Forum on Africa. He has also appeared on the Jon Stewart Daily Show and Good Morning America on ABC. To you, William, I say thank you for putting Malawi on the map. To the students of this school, I say, count yourselves lucky for being born or for having the opportunity of living in a country with such enormous wealth. Use this opportunity to be creative and innovative. And I was impressed outside when I came in to see already pictures and designs of new windmills. I was encouraged by what I saw. His book, William's book, has been translated in more than 15 languages already. And now I'm working with some American friends to have it translated in Chichewa, one of the vernacular languages in Malawi. Ladies and gentlemen, there's no one else who can better tell you this incredible story than the boy who harnessed the wind himself. It is therefore my great pleasure to introduce to you my compatriot, William Kankwamba, to tell you his amazing story.
Thank you. Good evening. Thank you so much, Ambassador Matenje, for your great words. As you have already know, I'm William Kankwamba from Malawi. I would like to thank all of you for coming tonight to listen to my story, to allow me to share my story with you tonight. I grew up in this small village in Malawi. So if you are not familiar with Malawi, Malawi is in Southeast Africa, bordered by Mozambique, Zambia, and Tanzania. So geographically, that's where Malawi is. I grew up in the family of 7 children, all sisters, excepting me. Life wasn't too easy for me growing up at school. Most of the time when I have a banana, some other guys, they say, give us your banana. When I say, no, I want to eat it, they say, no, you should give us because you don't have another brother to protect you. So most of the time I was just giving to them. But I guess I was too stubborn. I had my older sister. Instead of telling my older sister, I feel that I'll look weak in front of my sister by telling her that these guys are bothering me. Anyway, I survived from them. So, Malawi is more of an agricultural country. Most of the people in the rural area, they depend on farming. We grow lots of corn that we use for our main food. Our main food is nsima, which you can eat with vegetables and fish or beef. Farming is not an easy job. It's really a tough job. There's all kind of stuff that makes farming real tough. Price of fertilizer, price of seeds, and the weather. If the weather is not quite well, then you're going to be in trouble if you're a farmer. Or if the price of fertilizer goes up and you don't have enough money to buy it, then you can also be in trouble. So a farming life, it's real tough. One of these three things that I've mentioned happened in 2000. We experienced drought, and as the result, many people didn't harvest enough food than what they were expecting to harvest. Many people in rural areas, they grow their own food, which lasts them for the entire year. So at that particular year, because of the droughts, people only harvested a quarter amount of what they were expecting to harvest. So you can imagine harvesting only the quarter of what they were expecting to harvest made life real hard for everyone. A lot of people were starving to death. Even my family was badly affected by the situation. It was the same year that I was supposed to start a high school when we were experiencing this drought. So this is just like our main food, nsima. So because of the hunger that was happening, my parents didn't have enough money to pay for my school fees. So high schools in Malawi, you have to pay for it, while primary schools are for free. Because of the situation, all the money that my parents were funding, they were buying more corn that we can be able to eat. So when I started the high school, I was forced to drop out because my parents couldn't pay for it. When I had to drop out of high school, I looked at my father and looking those dry fields, it was the future I couldn't accept. I didn't want to become like him. I didn't want to become a farmer. I didn't want to become a farmer, not because I hate farming. No, I love farming. I didn't want to become a farmer because that's the only thing that I can do with my life. Which is the case for most people in my community, in my village. They are farmers, not by choice, but they are farmers because of the circumstances that they are in. They cannot do anything else with their life. So for me, I wanted to live the life where I can be able to determine what I want to do and when I want to do it. There was only one way for me to escape that cycle of becoming a farmer. It was through studies. So when I had to drop out of school, I was real sad. And I decided to continue with my studies through reading books. Like enough, the year that I graduated from primary school, they introduced a library at the primary school. So I decided to go there and start reading books. I was hoping that if I'll be able to read books, then I'll keep up with my schoolwork and I'll be in the same page with my friends who were going to school at that time. I was hoping that when the hunger will be over and my parents will find money, they will send me back to school. I shouldn't be very behind from everyone else who was going to school at that time. So when I started going to the library, I was mostly interested in reading textbooks that they were using at school. Sometimes I'll ask my friends who were still going to school at that time, "What did you study today?" They will tell me, and I'll take their notes. I'll go through them and reading at school at the library as well. So when I was growing up with my friends at primary school, we used to do many kind of games, and some of my friends were introduced to movies. And then they'll come up to school telling me that, "Oh, last night we watched this movie, and people were jumping up and down, we were seeing it on the grass." I was like, "How is it possible to see people doing action on like a piece of a grass? That must be weird. You can't see image of person in the grass." So most of the time, I wanted to have some answers. How was that possible? I remember at the same time, I used to think that inside the radio, there are small, tiny people who speaks. One day, my parents went somewhere else, and I finally like sneak in, and I took their radio, I opened it. I wanted to say hello to people who speaks. But I was surprised to see very tiny things that looks like beans. I was like, "Are these people? How can I tell?" I tried to twist one of it. I was hoping that if I pinch one little hard, it will scream that you are hating us. That didn't happen. So from there, I was able to putting one thing after another, putting one thing after another. So when I started developing this curiosity of trying to learn and understand how different things work. So when I was going up to the library, I found this book called Explaining Physics. I was hoping that through this book, I'll be able to get some of the answers that I had, how different things work. Because I remember asking people, "How does the car work?" They'll say, "You just put in gas and then you start the engine. That's how it works." I say, "Yes, I know you need to put in a gas, but how does the engine work when you put in a gas?" I had no answers. So when I saw this book, I was interested to find out how everything, like different things work. So I remember looking up in the book, I found the diagram. The diagrams, and they explain all about electromagnetics and how electricity can be generated. Although at that time, I couldn't read English that well, I was most of the time using these diagrams and reading the words around them to get understanding what they are trying to communicate. So one day, when I was at the library, I also found another book. The book called Explaining Physics. When I open inside the book, they say windmills could pump water and generate electricity. I have never seen a windmill before. So when I read the word pump water, it attracted my attention. I say, what can I do with the water that I can be able to pump from this windmill? I say, I can start irrigation, planting food 2 to 3 times a year instead of only one time waiting for the rain season to come. I thought that that was the answer towards the problem that we are facing at my house. I say, if I can be able to build this windmill, then I will start irrigation. I can be able to triple the amount of food that we grow each year. This hunger problem, it can be simply a history. But at the same time, I didn't have money to buy materials to build my windmill. So when I finally decided to build the windmill, I end up going to the junkyard, which was just next to my high school. My high school before turned to be a high school, it used to be a garage for a certain Tobago Estate Company. So when they stop operating from that site, they gave the place to the Minister of Education, and the Minister of Education turned that place into a school. So when I was going there to correct all of my pieces that I needed for my windmill, a lot of people were laughing at me. They thought that I'm going crazy. And my mom, she was so worried of me. I remember she telling me that you are no longer going to get married because no one wants to marry a crazy man. So regardless of what people were saying, at that time, I didn't stop doing what I wanted to do, stop with my idea and dream of building this windmill to generate electricity. So at the junkyard, I found a tractor fan, which I used as a center loader for my windmill. I also found a shock absorber, which I used as a shaft of the windmill. And using the PVC pipes, I was able to build my windmill. When I finished building this windmill, a lot of people start coming up to my house. They're always asking me, what is this? I will explain this windmill. I'm using it to generate power. So some of them, they say, what can you use the power from this windmill? I'll say, you can use this power to charge your cell phone or listen to radio or power up light bulbs. And some people had cell phone that time. They'll say, can I try to charge my cell phone? I say, of course. Then when we plug in the cell phone and it's showing that it's charging, I'll say, your cell phone, it shows that it's charging. So can you please now take your cell phone? Now you have proven that this thing can charge your cell phone. They say, no. I won't believe you. I'll believe you when my phone will be fully charged. So most of the time, I was just leaving them to charge their cell phones. So one thing that also happened after I finished building this windmill or that a lot of people started like coming, and also at the same time I didn't stop going to the library. One day the librarian asked me, "Why do you always check out the same book?" I explained that the book has helped me to build the windmill, which generated electricity. So she was interested to come and see the windmill by herself. When she came, she went back. And one day, the people who donate the book to the library were visiting all the libraries. And then the librarian told them what I have done from the knowledge that I get from the book that they donated. So they were also interested to come and see by themselves. They came and they went back and they came again, but this time around with some journalist who wrote an article about my story. So along the way, while I was still doing this windmill, I also had to make up some other adjustments so that I can be able to use it quite freely and easy. One of the things that I had to do was to build my own switch and my own circuit breaker. I built the circuit breaker so that I can protect my house from burning when the wires cross together. So when the journalist came to my place and read an article, that article was picked up by one of my friends now in the capital of Malawi, Lilongwe. He showed that paper to his boss, and his boss blogged it, put it on his blog. And someone here who was organizing the TED conference, which was held in Arusha, Tanzania, he was interested to invite me to attend the conference. But it was really hard to get in touch with me. He contacted the journalist who wrote the article, and the journalist contacted the people who brought them to the library, and the people who brought them to the house contacted the librarian, and the librarian contacted my cousin, and my cousin contacted my other cousin, and my other cousin contacted me. So I was somewhere else, like, it was a little tough to get to me. So when I had the news of going to the conference, I was so worried. Before then, I've never been outside my country, or I've never been so far even from my village. So one thing that worries me at that time was that traveling, I was told that I'll be going there by plane. So I was so worried how the experience in the plane is gonna be like. Like enough, I had people in my community who advised me. They say, "Son, we heard that you are going up in this long journey. Make sure that the night before your flight, you shouldn't eat." I say, "Well, why?" They say, "If you eat, you are going to vomit in the plane." So I didn't eat that night. So when I was inside the plane, I was so surprised to see that they were giving us food. I was like, "Do you want to embarrass me?" People in my village have already told me that I shouldn't eat. If I'll eat, I'll vomit. So I'm not gonna eat. Anyway, I guess people are just saying without really like knowing what really happens in the plane. So when I reached at the conference, I spoke very briefly about my work. And a lot of people came up to me. How can we help you? I say, I want to continue with my studies, and I also want to continue building more windmills, especially building windmills that can be able to pump water for irrigation. Because that was my original idea, was to build a windmill to pump water. But instead of building a windmill to pump water, I ended up building the windmill to generate electricity. Because at that time, I couldn't find the materials that I needed to build a water pump at the junkyard. So when I went back home, I was able to build this windmill, which was pumping water and also generating electricity at the same time. My mom was using this windmill, was using the water from the windmill to plant some vegetables. Some of it she was selling, some of it we are eating. So one thing that I did was I also went back to the high school, which I also wanted to continue and finish up with my studies. The high school that I went to was, I went to high school in Malawi and also went to high school in South Africa for 2 years where I finished up my high school. I went to African Leadership Academy. It's a new school which aims to transform future leaders of Africa. We are students from all over Africa. It was a real great experience to me to study from there. So at the conference, at the TED conference, it was the life-changing conference for me. A lot of new things started like happening to me. I was introduced to computers for the first time. My friends helped me to open up email address, which I had no idea about anything about the internet and all the wonders of the internet, that the information that I can be able to get that I needed when I was building up my windmill. So one thing that we were also able to start the nonprofit organization which aims to transform rural economic development in rural areas in Malawi. So one thing that we are trying to work on, is to rebuilding a primary school that I went to. A school that I went to was built almost 60 years ago with a capacity of 400 students. We were about 2,000 students the time I was going there. Most of the time, we were studying under the tree. When it is rain season, when the rain is coming, we are forced to stop the lessons and go back to our villages. And right now, there are almost 1,400 students. And the classes, they are not enough. Even the classes that they are there, they are really in bad shape. Some of them, they have holes on the roof. When it rains, it rings. So we are trying to rebuild a new one so that students can be able to study in a good environment. So in 2010, after I just graduated from high school, we were able to build a new school block with two classrooms. And for me, I was able to build a windmill and install a solar panels at this school. The idea is that at night, students can be able to go there and study, because most of them in their houses, they don't have electricity. So that we are hoping that at night they can be able to do their homework. But it's not only used by students. It is also used by the adults literacy program at night that are going there to start learning how to read. And we are also teaching some other way, modern ways of farming as well. So when I was building up the windmill for this school, I wasn't doing it only by myself. I was doing it together with the student from the school. I was hoping that if I'll be doing it with them, I'll be teaching them some of my skills that I have so that they can be able to build for their families or build for other people who want the same type of the system. So it was a real great experience for me to share my skills, some of my skills, with these students. Most of them, they are really like amazing students, but they didn't have like a chance before like to experience their skills. So I was hoping that through that system, we're going to be able to cover as much area as possible with this simple technology, but able to bring power to rural areas where it's really hard to bring in main power grid. So the same year, 2010, it was also the same year that I was about to graduate to go to. I graduated from high school from African Leadership Academy. So at that time, I also needed to apply to college. So one thing that I did, I was looking up for a college to apply to. So I looked at all the schools. I wanted to go to the school which have some engineering program so that I can be able to do some engineering program as well. So I end up applying to Dartmouth College, where I am right now. I'm in my second year. And this summer, continuing with the project that I'm doing in terms of trying to bring more power to some rural areas, is we are trying to build more windmills for the school so that the student can be able to use it, not only for the lighting, but also being able to use it for computers. We were fortunate enough that other people donate one laptop a child, and we are using the power from the windmill to power some of the computers. And one other project that I'm planning to do this summer is that I want to go back to Malawi with some of my friends in engineering program to do some engineering project there. We want to do engineering project at the high school that I dropped from. The school doesn't have a laboratory, so we are hoping that if we'll be able to install solar panels and build a windmill to power the school, we'll be able to use a projector with some computer, and we'll be able to record some laboratory classes from other school that have laboratory lab, and then use that lab classes from other school so that other students who learn by seeing, they can be able to understand what is going on. So these are some of the ideas that I'm planning to do this coming summer. So one thing that I'd like to leave you with tonight is that when I look back throughout my journey, the way that I have throughout my journey, since the time that I started dreaming of my windmill up to the time that I was able to accomplish up to this time, I have faced so many challenges, so many obstacles that could have simply stopped me from achieving what I wanted to do. Sometime in life, you face so many challenges. But don't allow those challenges to stop you from achieving what you want to achieve. Everything is possible. For me, I take as challenges being there, not to stop you, but to strengthen you to grow bigger with your ideas and to think deep with your ideas and dream. So many people in this world today who have done so many wonderful things, if you can ask them at some point, they faced some challenges, but they didn't give up with their dreams. That's why they were able to be success. So I just like to encourage you that regardless of who you are and where you are, at some point, you are going to face some challenges that will stop you from doing what you want to do. Don't give it up. Everything is possible. We have seen people doing it before, and you're going to be able to do it. There's nothing that will stop you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, William. On behalf of the Alexandria Library, we would like to give him a library card.
Thank you.
He, of all people, recognizes the value of a public library. And on behalf of the All Alexandria Reads Committee from the library, who, like Dr. Sherman, had the epiphany to use his book, I'd like to give him a pen that states, libraries build communities.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. One more round of applause, please.
Oh, this side. Okay. Thank you. I can't see.
You know, your phones ring at the most inopportune times. But I'm not going to take this call. Because William, by checking out a book from the public library, he was able to bring to his village not only electricity, but hope. And while Alexandria has had a subscription library since 1794, we celebrate our anniversary of having a public library this year. So we will be 75 years old as a public library. And what a better way to celebrate this momentous occasion than to ask the community to join in and help us read his particular book. Now, in William's book, he does what most scientists do. He asks a lot of questions. How? And then eventually he gets to the what if. And he achieves some amazing results. So tonight, I ask you, what if? What if? So I'm going to ask you to turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, come on. Are we strangers in here to you, everybody? Just turn to a neighbor and say, neighbor, what if?
What if?
What if?
What if all of us read the same book?
Excellent. So over the next month, as the library hosts some wonderful programs and book discussions concerning this particular book, I'm hoping that you will find the answers to that question. But for me, I have to pose the question to you this evening. So what if, in honor of the library's 75th anniversary, 7,500 Alexandrians decide to read his book in 75 days. Can we do it? I hope so. And so, we've been without our electronics for a while this evening. So now is the time for you to pull out your phone and make the call. I need for you to tell your family and your friends. Now is the time for us to, for you to take the time to answer the call. And the call is that All Alexandria Reads Challenge. And I need for you to join us in this call to arms. But All Alexandria needs to accept this call to action because it's a literacy call. And so I need for you to stop by the table out in the front where you'll find a program that lists all the wonderful programs that are going to be taking place in the libraries over the next 30 days. And beginning tomorrow. And so once you collect the program and you visit the libraries, we are hoping that you will help the library continue to build and transform our community, just as the boy who harnessed the wind. Thank you for coming this evening, and enjoy the rest of your night.